Good morning. This is Pastor Brian of New Life Community Church coming into your homes. And we are so glad you are joining us this morning. This is a new adventure for us, an adventure that comes from challenging times such as these. But our God is in control and His word is unstoppable. So we hope you will gather around with your loved ones and enjoy God's word this morning from Pastor Lewis. Please pray with me. Father, we thank you for your unfailing love, your goodness, and your faithfulness. We thank you for our church family, and we ask that you will bless us with your word this morning given by Pastor Lewis. Use him and use your word to encourage us, challenge us, and to draw us closer to our amazing God who reigns over all the earth. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Hey everyone, this is Pastor Luis Medrano coming to you from New Life Community Church. It is unfortunate that we can't be together in this building, but remember, as we've heard so often in these last days, this building is not the church. You and I are the church. We are a family, and I praise the Lord. I'm grateful to God that He's given us this medium of the internet in order to be able to spend some time in praise and prayer and worship together. So today, for this morning's message, I've been reflecting on a book that I read by Tom Brokaw. He named the book The Greatest Generation. And Tom focused his attention on a generation of people who lived during the Great Depression. That would have been 1929 through 1939. This was a time of scarcity, of uncertainty, and of suffering. And just think, getting through that time period where people didn't have food, they didn't have work, they had lost their homes, they were struggling. This was an incredible time of hardship. And just as they're coming out of this time, a huge day comes, December 7, 1941. It would be a day that our president, Franklin Roosevelt, said would be a day that would live in infamy. It described a day when the Empire of Japan attacked Pearl Harbor and drew the United States into the most devastating war of all time, where at its end, nearly 70 million people had lost their lives. The people that lived during this time, at least in Tom Brokaw's book, were coined the Greatest Generation. Now, the reason that he did this, the reason he called them the Greatest Generation, is because of their reaction to hardship, to suffering, and to crisis. Coming out of a Great Depression only to go into the World War, where countries, the world, was struggling and suffering. How did this generation respond? They responded by everyone in the community doing their part. People joined the military, and if they couldn't join the military, they bought war bonds, they volunteered in the hospitals, they went to work in the factories, men and women, and even the youth. Everyone was doing their part in this great war. And why? Because the United States was now in a war where the Allies were facing some of the most heinous and evil leaders that history has seen. And even private companies transitioned themselves to help in the war effort. Everybody worked. Everyone sacrificed. Everyone did their part. And they have left us a legacy of courage, of perseverance, and a willingness to struggle together. What they did shaped the very country that we have today. Everything that we enjoy had a part in being kept together by this generation. And you know what's interesting? That if you talk to these people, because there's still some left from that generation, they don't consider themselves great. That sounds odd to them. And if you ask them, well, why did you do what you did? What was on your mind? They'll just tell you that they did their part, and that they did it because it was the right thing to do. You see, what seems to separate that generation from ours, and to be honest, all others, is that they, unlike us, they saw hardship and suffering as a natural part of life. They understood that life is fragile, and so they weren't surprised when unjust things happened, when plagues or viruses came, when famine or war or scarcity was taking place. I really think that we have lost this sense. Because see, we live in a time, we are a generation that sees hardship and suffering as something that we can avoid. We think that if we have enough money, enough influence, enough power, enough control, somehow we can get away not struggling and not suffering. We see hardship and suffering as something that doesn't belong in our reality. And if we can just take a pill, if we can just get counseling or therapy, if we can just escape, that everything will be fine. And we as a generation don't seem to have, in large part, the coping mechanisms that are required to deal with hardship and suffering. So today, I'm sharing this message. I'm calling it a message of hope, in hope of reclaiming some of that courage, some of that perseverance and strength to work through whatever hardship and whatever suffering may come. Now, of course, this message is in part a response to the crisis that we're presently in with COVID-19. I know that. But if we're honest, even before COVID-19 hit, we were struggling with a whole host of problems. We had issues before this virus ever hit, both personally and nationally. We were looking at a time where people were struggling in relationships, economically, socially, culturally. We're at war. We're fighting the anger, the lack of compassion, the lack of care. There was chaos before COVID-19 ever hit. And even though you may not want to accept it, even though you may not admit it, you and I both had some things that needed to be dealt with. And so we need some strategies to face it. Because this, let's say that by the grace of God we get through this, guess what? There's going to be more. Our lives will be filled with hardships, with suffering, and with challenges. And if we don't figure out how to respond to them, then we're always going to be panicking, always going to have anxiety. You know, in the last few weeks, last few days, I've had quite a few texts that are all asking me questions such as, Pastor, what's going on? What's God doing? Why is God doing this? Where is God? Doesn't He care about what's going on? And so there's all these folks who are panicking. I get it. I understand that. But they're looking at God as somehow He's responsible for our pain and suffering, or that He doesn't care about our pain and suffering. And so as a pastor, all I can do is go to the source of information that God has given us, the Scriptures. And I want to read to you a passage that I've often referred to in my Bible studies. And I think it's a good place to start in understanding what's happening and how should we be responding. Paul, the apostle, in Romans chapter 15, verse 4, says these words, "For whatever was written in former days was written for our instruction, that through endurance and through encouragement of the Scriptures, we might have hope." So what the apostle Paul is saying, listen, I know you're going through some hard times. And so what do? We go back to the Scriptures, and specifically the Old Testament. In the Old Testament, you're going to receive instructions. And if you follow these instructions, if you're obedient to these instructions, you're going to have hope. You're going to get past this panic. You're going to get past this anxiety. You're going to feel a deep sense of peace. So this morning, that's what I want to do. I want to go into the Old Testament. I want to find that instruction and that encouragement that gives us hope. And so to begin with, let's do that. We're going to go into the book of Exodus, one of the most magnificent books in the Old Testament dealing with hardship and suffering. The Bible says that the nation of Israel, at that time known as the Hebrews, they had fallen into some poor practices. You know, oftentimes when we look through the book of Exodus, we think to ourselves, Pharaoh and the Egyptians were the bad guys, and the Hebrews were the good guys. Well, the truth is that neither one of them was good, for all had sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. You see, even the Hebrews had fallen to idolatry. That 400 years of hardship and suffering and slavery, it came because of a reason. And they were struggling. And so we're going to look at that moment in time. But we also have to recognize, before we analyze that situation, we need to deal with something. And it's the reason why everyone's questioning God. The reason why we're panicking and we don't understand. The question has been, can we trust God? What's he up to? Why is he allowing this? Why doesn't he care? You know, over the years, we've heard a lot of people describing God. I've heard sermons and pastors and teachers, smart people, not so smart people, and everybody wants to tell you what God's like. Well, he's this old man sitting on a throne in heaven, and he's this angry old guy, or he's this, he's that. And it seems like everyone has some kind of description or interpretation of who God is. Here's a bright idea. How about we ask him? How about we say, God, reveal yourself? And that's not crazy, because in the book of Exodus, after God had liberated his people from Egypt, he had them in the desert, and the people disobeyed God. They revealed their slave mentality, their sheepishness, if you would, and they strayed from their shepherd, God. And they made a golden calf, and this really upset the Lord. And we can look into this moment where Moses is speaking with the Lord, and God is upset, and Moses is really stressed out, because he's thinking, these people, they've ruined what we have. God's going to be angry. He's going to abandon us. We're going to die. This is not a good situation. And so Moses goes after God, and he says, God, please, don't abandon us. Show me your ways. Reveal yourself to me so that I can understand you better. And hopefully, by understanding you better, we won't let you down again. Please, reveal yourself to me. Let me know your ways that I may know you. By chapter 33, verse 18 in the book of Exodus, he says, I pray you, show me your glory. And God, with great mercy and compassion, he looks at Moses and he says, Moses, I know your name. I know who you are. You don't need to get all riled up. You don't need to panic. You don't need to be anxious. Listen, there's something that you're asking me, and I'll be up front with you. You can't handle it. I'm too big for you. And so what I'm going to do is I'm going to put you in the cleft of this rock, and I'm going to let my glory come by. But I'm going to cover you with my hand so that you aren't harmed by seeing me. And after I've gone by, I'll reveal to you my back so that you'll have some understanding of who I am. Well, this was good news for Moses. And he would reveal himself. He would reveal himself in another way. You see, there's this one moment in the Old Testament, and it is cited throughout the Old and the New Testament, where God says, Moses, you really want to know me? Let me tell you who I am. And we find God's own description of himself in the book of Exodus, chapter 34, verse 6. The Bible says, the Lord passed before him, and he proclaimed, the Lord, a God, merciful and gracious, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love and faithfulness. God could have said at this moment that the Lord, a powerful and angry and quick judge who is ready to punish people. No. How does God speak to Moses? How does he reveal himself? How does he reveal his beauty, his reputation, his character? How does God see himself? He says, the Lord God, merciful. Merciful. What is mercy? Mercy is when someone deserves punishment, but that punishment is withheld. God says, Moses, you want to know who I am? The most outstanding attribute that would be of interest to you? If you want to know who I am at the core of my being, what I am in essence, it's I am merciful. I know that lots of people say that God is this and God is that, but God says of himself, I am merciful. That's how you can know me. When you're asking these questions, where is God? What's God doing? Why is God doing? Always understand who he is. He is merciful. And that means He cares for us. This reveals His character, His beauty, and His reputation. Mercy is connected with compassion. And so, does God see what's happening today? Yes, He does. Because of His mercy. I want to share with you Psalm 103, verse 13. Listen to what the Bible says about His mercy and His compassion. It says, just as a father has compassion on his children, so the Lord has compassion on those who fear Him. And He brings into light the most intimate of relationships of a parent with their child. For all of you who have children, how much do you love your children? You'll know that your love is immeasurable. And God says, I see you that way. I care about what's happening to you. We also find in the Gospels where Jesus looked upon Jerusalem. He looked upon the suffering and the hardships of the people. And He said, and the Bible says that He was sad because He had compassion on them. You see, this is something important. God is compassionate. God is loving. God is kind. And He cares about what is happening. It says, the Lord, a God merciful and gracious. You see, this is something incredible. Because of His mercy, because of His compassion, He will never forsake us. He'll never abandon us. He will always be available. And even though He is infinitely holy, He will always be able to deal gently with compassion with those of us that are weak and failing. He is full of tender sympathy for our suffering. And then this beautiful grace. Grace is unmerited favor. What you don't deserve, because of God's grace, He gives it to you. You see, grace allows a strong one to approach and come near in the aid of a weak one. Grace is what draws God to us. And so if I can give you an illustration, when God is revealing Himself, he's saying this. Pretend now that this is you, that this is me, and this is God. What God's desire is to do this, to hold us in His hand, to cover us, to protect us, to love us, to care for us, to provide for us. This is God's will for His people. But because of our free will and because of our nature, what do? We shake and we fight and we pry ourselves away from God. Why? Because we want to be our own gods. We want to do what we want to do. We are egotistical. We are selfish. And we just simply want our space. Like a teenager who's tired of their parent, they pull away. And what do those teenagers say? You don't understand me. You don't love me. You don't care for me. That seems to be what God is dealing with when we pull away from Him. He pulls away. And it isn't God that is abandoning us. You see, these Egyptians, they were living in the consequence of their own actions. And if there's anything that marks our generations is that we don't deal well with consequences. We're trying to create a world without consequences. That we can do what we want to do and never have to pay for any of it. You see, and that's just not the way God has prepared this universe. And so God loves us. He cares for us. But there are times in history where we pull away. And so we are separated. When you think of Adam and Eve, when they sinned in the garden, what happened with them in the garden? They were cast out. There was a separation. Sin is separating from God. God isn't abandoning. God isn't leaving. God isn't punishing. We are pulling away. And there's this space between us. So what do we do? We're going to stick with this narrative in the book of Exodus, and we're going to see at least four things that we can do in order to restore the relationship with God and know what do we do during this time of crisis. We're stuck in our houses. We don't know what to do. I think we can find some guidance here in the scriptures. And so we're going to go back to the book of Exodus and think about this. If it is true that we have separated from God, God allows us to do what we want to do. He's not going to force His relationship on us. He's going to leave us be, and we're going to do what we want, just like the Hebrews did, just like many of us do. And over time, what happens? We struggle. We suffer. Hardship and suffering happen. It always does. It's a natural part of life. But it wasn't until the Hebrew people gave up on all of their own devices when they began to cry out. See, the Hebrew people were tired. Imagine being a Hebrew in that slavery in Egypt where your daughters could be raped at any time, violated at any time, where your sons could be killed, your family's abused, you don't know what's happening with your family, and the only respite, the only rest you might get is death. It was a horrible existence, and they were giving up on everything. And they were thinking the same things. Where is God? Why doesn't he care? Why is he abandoning us? And at last, what did they do? They cried out to God. You see, one of the first things that I think we ought to be thinking about during this time of crisis, if we have separated and we are in hardship and suffering, one of the best things that we can do is cry out to God. Instead of panicking, I mean, the truth is when crisis comes by nature, it's almost our DNA, we have to do something. We don't know what to do. And so what are most people doing? They've got to do something, so they shop. We're going to go to the store, and it's a form of comfort. At least we feel like we're doing something. Well, how about we take this consideration? Instead of panicking, instead of going and buying out every store, why don't we cry out to God? Why don't we stay at home and we spend some time in prayer? I mean, seriously, I can't judge anyone, but isn't prayer one of those areas that we can really use some practice in? Maybe we've been so busy with work and with projects. Well, guess what? Work and projects may not be in the way anymore. Can we cry out to God? And what's beautiful about this is after they have cried out to God, the moment they cry out to God, how does God respond? Well, we continue seeing in the book of Exodus chapter 3 that after 400 years, the people finally cry out to God, and God looks for and brings in a deliverer. And it's amazing what we find here. The Bible says that God comes to Moses and he says, I have seen the troubles of my people and I have heard their cries. I've heard their cries. When God's people pray, God hears. When you are tired of the separation, when you're tired of the suffering, being alone, feeling abandoned, we cry out to God. And he hears and he responds. So God goes to Moses and he says, Moses, I want you to go to Pharaoh and I want you to tell him, let my people go. I want them back. We're going to reconnect. But here's a very essential part of the story that often gets overlooked. You see, when God comes back and he's going to deal with the Hebrew people and with the Egyptians, most of us feel like, okay, God, we're struggling. Save me. Take care of me. You say you're a God of love, so do that. God is a God of love. But watch what happens. When Pharaoh doesn't respond, and God told Moses he wouldn't respond, he tells him, I'm going to bring plagues. I'm going to bring pestilence. I'm going to bring a virus. I'm going to bring disease. I'm going to bring natural phenomena. And the reason I'm doing it is not because I'm angry. It's not because I'm hateful. It's not because I'm punishing. It's because when we separate from God, there's space, and we allow things to be connected to us that don't belong in our lives. You see, God doesn't want to share your heart with all of your idols. God doesn't want to share your life with all of these sinful things. He wants to be the center of your life, your soul point of confidence. And so what do we see? When God sends the plagues, each and every one of those plagues was not so much an attack on the Egyptians or the people. Those attacks were attacks against the gods of Egypt. Every single one of those plagues was attacked. So when God transformed the blood in the Nile River, he was attacking an Egyptian god. These were the gods that both the Egyptians and many of the Hebrews were worshiping, were adoring. They were the idols in their life. And God was demonstrating to all people that these idols that you've placed your confidence in, they will fail you. You see, that's what suffering does in this world. Whatever you put your trust in, whether it's position, power, money, when hardship and suffering comes, it can take it all away from you. There is nothing you have that hardship and suffering can't take away. And God comes in with his plagues, and he reveals to both Egyptian and Hebrew, he's saying, I'm cleaning house. None of your idols, none of your gods can handle me. I need to be the sole source of your comfort and your help. You don't need them. So the plagues come to clean all the junk off of you and off of me that is keeping him from reconnecting. He doesn't just want to be a fad in your life. He doesn't want to be a temporary fix. He doesn't want to be a bandage. He wants to be your closest companion. He wants to be your God. And so he goes to work, and sometimes this is a surgery that is really hard. And what he's doing with the Egyptians and the Hebrews is he's forcing them to enter into a time where nothing is normal. What comes natural is no longer acceptable. And I want you to think right where you're sitting right now, what is it that's natural? What is it that's normal to you that may no longer be acceptable? What is it in your life that needs to change? What must you reprioritize? You see, if we've learned anything in the last few days, is that God is calling us to reprioritize our lives. You haven't gone to church. Why? Because you've been busy and you've had projects and you've had this. Guess what? You don't have that anymore. You can spend some time reading your Bible, calling other brothers, studying in your home. You have time. So not only are you going to call out to God, you're going to take this opportunity and you're going to look at your life and you're going to say, where do I need to reprioritize? Where are you going to get rid of these idols in your life? Let me put it this way. The junk has to go. What is the junk in your life that has been tripping you up? What has been causing you so much hardship? And get that junk out. You see, God wants to close in, but he's got to clean that off first. He's got to take away all that junk. You see, I think that the Hebrew people, they saw their slavery as simply physical. But God saw past that. He said, you know, this isn't just about your slavery. It isn't about the fact that you're sick and dying and there's injustice and there's all the... No, before we deal with the problems outside, let's deal with the problems inside. You see, how long did it take God to break the Hebrews out of Egypt? One night. One night. He was able to rescue them in one night. How long did it take for him to change their slave mentality, the way they think? How long did it take to help them reprioritize their lives? 40 years in the desert. Because people don't like to change. They don't want to change. They want to be their own gods. That's why they made that golden calf. That's why they constantly disobeyed. And you know, one of the saddest parts of the book of Exodus is those people that came out, they were both Egyptian and Hebrews, and for 40 years, God was attempting, but there comes a point in time where God has to speak to those people, and he says, you know what? I love you. I have mercy on you. I have grace. I'm long-suffering. But this is one of those moments where it's not me, it is you. And I know you're just not responding. And so I need to bring some change. And for you, you're going to stay in this desert. You're going to die here. And my hope is that your children will learn and they will grow and that they'll see the promised land. What if what's happening today is simply God helping us reprioritize our lives? You know, all I can do is speak personally, but in these last few days, I've changed a lot of my habits. I'm sleeping better, something that I wasn't doing. I'm eating better. I'm actually getting exercise. I always had an excuse as to why I couldn't do it, and God showed me that I need to do these things. And so I'm reprioritizing. It doesn't come natural, believe me. Yesterday I was walking and I wanted to sit so bad, but I just pushed ahead. I need to get healthy. I need to focus. And because I work so much, I often don't get time with my children and with my wife. And now I'm reprioritizing that. You know, I've been calling my friends and family. I just want to hear their voice. And because I'm not so tired, I'm not as cranky and have more patience. And I'm reconnecting with my children. And you know, something that we've done in these last few days that we haven't done in a long time, we sat at the kitchen table. And we had a Bible study together. We're having spiritual conversations. We're reconnecting in ways we hadn't done in a long time. In the midst of this crisis, there are some blessings to be found. And maybe God is telling us all right now, it's time to cry out to Him. It's time to pray for your family. It's time to reprioritize your life, what you consider as important. And I hope that you have that opportunity. The third thing I'm going to say is that there are many at that time that were given God's warning. As a matter of fact, God told everybody. He told Moses, "Moses, I want you to go and tell the Hebrews that at the certain day on the 14th of Nisan, I'm going to come in and the angel of death is coming into your community." And so I want every father to choose a lamb. And he says, "I want you to take a lamb. I want you to take the lamb. I want you to take your lamb home. Because I want you to have this food that you're going to eat on this evening. You're going to use this. You're going to need this food. Take it home. Make sure it's in your home. And then I want you to take your wife and your kids, and I want you to get in your house. I want you to shut the door. I want you to shut the windows. And I don't want you to come out. You need to stay in your doors." As a matter of fact, the Bible tells us in the book of Exodus, chapter 11, that the angel of death is coming. And later on in chapter 12, he says, "Don't you dare go out of your doors." What's God doing? He's quarantining them. He's saying, "Use wisdom, use understanding, stay indoors, follow my instruction." And if I can be honest with you, one of the things that's frustrated me quite a bit lately, even though I don't say much, it's that there are people who just don't want to follow instructions. Folks, can I share something with you? I know that I've been hearing a lot of super spiritual people lately saying, "Well, I'm not afraid, I have faith." There's a time for wisdom and understanding to come into play. And the wisdom that we understand right now, the wisdom just like God told the people, this is what you're dealing with, we've been told what we're dealing with. And because of our own arrogance, we refuse to follow instructions. And you have to understand, what we're dealing with as far as COVID-19 is that you can be infected. You could have this virus, but yet not feel it for 2 weeks. That means you feel great. And I know I've heard people say things like, "I'm not afraid." It's not about you. Because you feel good and you feel great. You're going to the store, you're meeting friends, you're hugging people, you're shaking hands, you're doing all these things because you feel good. But in those 2 weeks, how many people are you contaminating and where are they taking it to? What we're doing here at this church is not out of fear. It's out of love for our neighbor. I understand I feel good, but I need to care about the youngest. I need to care about our elders. We need to care about each other enough to follow instructions, especially when we've been told what we're dealing with. This is not an issue of faith. Faith is not burdened by us taking precaution. This is where that old saying might come in. It's better to be safe than sorry. But you know, I go to the scriptures and I find this in Exodus chapter 12, verse 22. To me, it's very clear. God says here in the scriptures that we are to stay indoors. Why don't we do that? In the book of Proverbs, allow me to find this for you. In the book of Proverbs, chapter 22, verse 3. I find so much joy when scriptures make it clear to me. Allow me to read this to you. Proverbs chapter 22, verse 3. It says, "The prudent," you can put in there wise, "the prudent sees danger and hides himself, but the simple go on and suffer for it." The wise sees danger and hides himself, but the simple go on and suffer for it. Folks, it's time to understand that we need wisdom and understanding. Yes, there's going to be all sorts of people who tell you what they think. There's going to be someone who finds some doctor somewhere that says something. Use wisdom, use understanding, and care for your brethren, care for those in your life. And it is better to be safe than sorry. The fourth and the last thing I'm going to say here is that the Bible teaches that Moses spoke to his people and he said, "That lamb that you have there," this is where God reveals the most important thing. We are to cry out to God. We are to look at where we are to reprioritize our life. We are to use wisdom and understanding. But most importantly, this whole Exodus is about something more. He says, "Take the blood of that lamb and put it on the doorpost and the lentils of your house. And when the angel of death comes, he's going to pass over it." And that door is a symbol that each and every person needs the blood of the Lamb to be over the door of their home, to be over the door of your heart. You need to reconnect with God. You need to reconnect with Jesus. And maybe with the time that you've been given now, it's a time to get to the scriptures, a time to pray, a time to reconnect with God. This is what we can do right now. And when your trust in Him grows, so will your faith. And no matter what happens, because folks, remember, today it's COVID-19, but there'll be something else tomorrow. How can we be a great generation? We can be a generation that pulls together, that we're not reacting like the rest of the world. We react like people who have hope, and our hope comes from the scriptures, a pattern that God has set. When difficult times come, when hardship comes, the coping mechanism of a Christian is to pray, to be willing to grow and to change, to use wisdom and understanding, and to ensure that they are in a right relationship with their Creator, to have Jesus on your heart. Maybe that's what we need to be doing today. Well, I pray that this message is a blessing to you, it's a comfort to you, because we do serve a God who is merciful, compassionate, gracious, long-suffering, a God who is kind, who cares for us. He does not abandon us. He will not abandon us. He will come to us in our time of need. He will protect. He will provide. He will walk with us. Don't be afraid. Don't be afraid, for God is with us. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, on this morning, we pray for our families, our church, our community, our national leaders in the world. We pray for those that are suffering, those that are in bondage, those that need you. We ask that you help us see the world the way you see it, that your priorities become our priorities. Lord, that you may be glorified as you work through this present crisis and those to come. Help us to represent you well. We ask this in the precious name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Well, as we close this time together, I want to share a time of worship, but just a song to comfort our souls and to remind us that all is well.
is well. It is well with my soul.
Thank you, Pastor Lewis, for your encouraging message. I hope we all found it as vital and important as I did. If you want to stay connected to us here at New Life Community Church, we invite you to connect with us through our Facebook page. If you have a prayer request, a special need, or you'd like to know more information about our hope and faith in Jesus Christ, please go to our website, www.newlifescottsdale.org. There you'll find contact information, and you can call us, leave a message, and we'll get back to you. Thank you again for joining us today. We pray that you'll keep on serving our Lord, sharing your faith, and praying, and stay well.